the Dead Sea Scrolls, who wrote them? And could these scrolls provide clues to hidden treasures?
We're most famous for our program whereby people sign up to be frozen when they die. We take anybody.
He knew nothing about extraterrestrial crafts. They were beyond his 16th century comprehension.
From the boundaries of the universe to the depth of your soul, embark on a journey through the unknown and unexplained as we explore mysteries, magic, and miracles. Hello and welcome. I'm Patrick Macnee. Today, we'll see how science and medicine are working together to preserve human life by freezing people. And we look into the mysterious legend of the Seven Cities of Gold. But first, what are the facts and the myths surrounding the Dead Sea Scrolls? For almost 2,000 years, a treasure of inestimable value was hidden in hillside caves near the Dead Sea. Not only has its discovery caused great controversy, it has also created an ongoing drama and questions that are still unanswered. The Dead Sea Scrolls raised many questions. Who wrote them? What is their impact on two of the world's great religions, Judaism and Christianity? And could these scrolls provide clues to hidden treasures? To start at the beginning, in 1947, two shepherds were tending their goats in the barren hills surrounding the Dead Sea. A strange opening on the side of a hill lured them to take a closer look. Out of curiosity, they threw stones inside.
When the stones landed, they heard pottery break.
One of the shepherds was lowered down in the cave. His discovery was phenomenal. A large group of ancient pottery jars.
And in some of those jars were ancient parchment manuscripts, and those were the first scrolls that were found.
Although the parchments were badly decomposed, it was possible to see that they were inscribed in a strange handwriting.
The Dead Sea Scrolls are ancient Jewish documents, about 800 different scrolls that were discovered in caves near a place called Qumran, and then later on in several other different areas along the western shore of the Dead Sea.
The discovery of the Dead Sea Scrolls caused heated controversy among scholars. For the public, they became a subject of intense drama, and people's imaginations ran wild. It was even suggested that these scrolls predict the future or contain answers to life's mysteries. One fact was clear. These ancient manuscripts comprise the oldest copies of the Bible in existence.
They take our copies of the Hebrew Bible back over 1,000 years. The total span is about 3rd century B.C., to 2nd century AD.
It took years for information from the Dead Sea Scrolls to become public.
It was a huge, huge project to put thousands, tens of thousands of pieces together.
Once the scholars were able to decipher the scrolls, they revealed fascinating information. The Dead Sea Scrolls were written during a turbulent and critical period in the history of the Jewish people, on the eve of the birth of Christianity. Parchments made from goat or sheepskins were used for the scrolls. The writing utensils were extraordinary.
The feather or quill of a kosher bird, since that was the tradition in writing Hebrew manuscripts.
The scrolls were written in three different languages, Hebrew, Aramaic, and Greek. There was, however, one scroll different from the others. Broken in two pieces and too brittle to unroll, a scroll made out of copper was found in 1952. The copper scroll contains a long list of hiding places of treasures of enormous value. Hidden in wells, tombs, and near certain trees and springs, 200 tons of silver and gold are still buried. No one has been able to find these hiding places. Some scholars believe the list to be purely symbolic, but There are others who think it may be a catalogue of the treasures of King Solomon's temple. To this very day, the copper scroll is a tantalizing enigma, an inspiration to many a treasure hunter. Multispectral cameras have shown us distant galaxies and star clusters. Now, Gregory Biermann uses these cameras to decipher badly damaged fragments of the scrolls.
The original fragment that we had was smaller than a postage stamp. It was only about this big. And they were all kept in Jerusalem and Israel. However, it turned out that there was a small fragment, I mean small, that was already here in the United States, here in Los Angeles. And we called the people that were using this and asked them if we could borrow it for our imaging tests. And they said yes. And they, in fact, said that, well, there's no writing on it. There's no text on it. So sure, you can go ahead and borrow it. So we borrowed it, and we put it on our imaging system. And we discovered that there was indeed text on it. And there were three words on it. And the first two words were, he wrote the words of Noah. And the fragment is from a document called the Genesis Apocryphon. It's not recognized as part of the Bible, retelling of the stories of Genesis. So it's Genesis, and that has the story of Noah. So it makes sense that, that's a word that you would expect to find, so it all sort of falls into place.
There are still many scrolls that remain untranslated. Until all the scrolls have been decoded, no one can know for sure how many more secrets they will reveal. With an aura of reverence surrounding it, the Dead Sea Scrolls will continue to be an enigma. Whether this enigma could be solved altogether is another question. What would happen if years into the future you woke up and found yourself in a world of strangers? This scary but fascinating truth can happen for those who want to be frozen until a new age arrives.
Today, bloodless surgery is performed more and more for delicate and dangerous surgeries. But how would this technology affect humankind in the future? Cryonics is the study of low-temperature preservation of human life.
The American Cryonics Society in Sunnyvale, California is a nonprofit corporation with over 100 members.
We're most famous for our program whereby people sign up to be frozen when they die.
Jim says there are about 50 to 55 people frozen worldwide, most of them in the United States.
Trans Time Incorporated, a facility that prepares and stores suspended bodies, was one of the first ones in the world. Art Quaife has maintained the facility since its beginning in 1974.
If one of our patients died in a local hospital, we would dispatch an ambulance to pick him up, transport the patient back here in this in our TransTime cooler.
Carmen Brewer found out about cryonics through a free weekly that came to her door. She became interested in cryonics after reading an article in it.
I would rather be frozen with the hope of coming back than to be buried.
The patient would be packed in ice. There's a pump here to keep ice water circulating to speed up the cooling even greater.
Someday, and I am in one way dreading this, we're apt to get someone sign up who is on death row.
So we're keeping the patient in nearly the same physiological state as he was in when he died while we get him here. And then the next step would be to move him into our surgery room.
What would happen if a really terrible Charles Manson were to sign up for cryonic suspension? We take anybody. We don't try to prejudge people. We don't try to decide who is worthy of cryonic suspension and who is not.
This is the surgery room where the main part of the cryonic suspension procedure takes place.
If Hitler were alive today and applied, we'd sign him up.
For criminals such as these, the question is not whether or not they should be frozen, but whether or not they should be thawed. That's a question for future society to decide.
So I'm still very careful about my life, my body, and because I want to take it to the future for a long, long trip.
We would do surgery and wash out the patient's blood, replace it with a blood substitute that we had developed. While continuing to cool the patient internally by perfusing this cold fluid into them.
I am all signed up to be suspended, as is my wife, my daughter, my grandkids.
After we finish the surgery, we next cool the patient down to the temperature of dry ice. Then we move the patient over into one of these cryogenic storage capsules behind me, where over a period of a couple of weeks, he will just be slowly cooled to the temperature of liquid nitrogen, which is minus 196 degrees centigrade.
I have no fear, the fear of dying is not the thing, it's just the love of living.
Finally, we remove the patient from that capsule and transfer into this large dewar here for long-term storage.
A few people have made arrangements to have just their head, and in a couple of cases, just brains have been suspended. These people believe that probably the brain is really what we want to have preserved, and they think that a body could be grown around the brain sometime in the far future.
We have four whole body patients and five neural preservations, in which case only the head is maintained.
People aren't the only ones frozen. Some who plan to be suspended upon death have their animals suspended as well, so they can go together in the future. Both cats and dogs have been frozen, including Flash, this loved Labrador from Australia. Although people can be frozen today, they cannot be thawed. While some patients in brain or heart surgeries are brought down to freezing and thawed with no problems, damage to the body at temperatures as low as the temperature of liquid nitrogen are irreparable today.
People frozen by the techniques of today, my speculation is that it's at least 50 years and maybe as long as 200 years until it'd be possible to restore them to life.
What I would like, if I'm revived, I think I would like to look good. I mean, you know, look decent and feel good.
If there is a soul, what happens to it during this human hibernation? Does it leave the body and then come back when the body is revived?
If there is a soul, I mean, to me, it's part of everything, okay? It's spiritual and physical and mental. It's a package, okay? You're all one package. I believe that everything that's me, spiritual, physical, mental, will stay with me.
For the first time in history, we're on the verge of being able to re-engineer ourselves through genetic engineering. We can improve ourselves and extend our lifespans indefinitely into the future.
I love my life. I love life. I was given life. If there is such a thing as a creator or whatever, I think he would appreciate my love for life.
My reason for wanting to be suspended was simply I want to live forever. If cryonics works, great. You've gained an awful lot. If it doesn't work, you've lost very little.
I'm so glad I found this. I'm so, so glad that I found cryonics.
Mortality or immortality? We may one day have a choice.
Our recent story on acupuncture may have made your skin tingle. But its remarkable results attest to how little we truly know about the human body. Patient Alejandro Mendez was suffering from near total facial paralysis. With the help of skilled doctors, he has already improved considerably. Vipada, a stroke victim, was turned down by Western doctors and sought acupuncture as a last resort. Today, however, she follows a busy schedule, managing the restaurant she had only months earlier given up after losing hope of recovery. Acupuncture has given her back her life. It is said that explorers in the 16th century saw golden cities on the horizon as they journeyed across seemingly uninhabited territory. Was this a mirage, an overactive imagination, or could it have been one of the first sightings of UFOs? The seven golden cities of Cibola, the legendary cities of incredible riches sought by 16th century Spanish conquistadors. Several credible persons said that they have seen them, yet when expeditions retraced their paths, the golden cities seemed to have vanished into thin air. One modern-day Swiss researcher believes that they did indeed vanish. because they were actually huge extraterrestrial ships. It all started with a Spanish sailor named Cabeza de Vaca, shipwrecked in 1528 off the coast of what would later become Texas. He spent 8 years wandering across northern Mexico until he finally reached the Spanish settlement of Culiacan. There, he told an incredible story of seeing seven amazing golden cities on the horizon. He said they were so imposing and foreign that he was afraid to go near them. His report was convincing enough to prompt Mendoza, the viceroy of New Spain, to send Fray Marcos de Niza on a mission to find the cities of gold. 1 year later, de Niza returned with positive confirmation that he had seen the cities in the distance, but with his small expeditionary contingent, he too was afraid to approach them. However, he said the cities were actually 300 miles east of where de Vaca had reported them. After hearing this, Mendoza sent the great explorer Francisco Vázquez de Coronado with an expedition force of more than 1,000 to conquer the golden cities once and for all. Coronado found no cities at the spot where they were reported to be. But later, however, his continuing search led him to discover one of the natural wonders of North America, the Grand Canyon. Still, without the golden cities, Coronado returned in disgrace. Then in 1550, Francisco de Ibarra, governor of Nueva Vizcaya, received surprising information. He was told that some years ago, members of an Indian village had seen seven golden cities in western central Mexico, 800 miles south of de Vaca's sighting. Ibarra traveled to the Indian village and heard an amazing story of huge golden objects that had come down from the sky and landed in the distance and covered great areas of the earth. 2 days later, the enormous golden objects once again flew away, just as mysteriously as they had arrived. The Indians believed these could only have been sent by the Great Spirit as a divine event. So they carved their recollections of the occurrence on rocks on a nearby mountain to remain forever. Ibarra had never heard of such an incredible thing as huge golden objects falling from the sky. He climbed to the place on top of the mountain to see the rock carvings for himself, hoping to glean some sort of clue. He studied the petroglyphs with great interest. And after hearing the Indian story and seeing it carved in stone, Ibarra spent many hours watching the sky for the return of these enormous golden objects. But to his disappointment, they never came. For the last 10 years, Dr. Helmut Kroller has studied the connection between 16th century petroglyphs found in many areas of Mexico and the accounts of the seven golden cities.
Cabeza de Vacas said he saw the cities in the distance. Cities was the best word he had to describe them. He knew nothing about extraterrestrial crafts. They were beyond his 16th century comprehension. He described them as vast golden areas shining in the distance, and at night they lighted up the sky. Coronado went to the exact location, and when he went there, they were gone. And the others saw the cities, but in different locations. The solution to the mystery lies in the Indian petroglyphs. They are the Indian records of the landing of the spacecraft. These occur in many areas of Mexico, but the images are always the same. Why? Because they are the same ships landing in different areas. There are always two types of spacecraft depicted in the petroglyphs. One is a circle with rays radiating from it. We can judge size by relating to other objects of the petroglyphs. The other one is shaped like two connected circles. This ship is much larger. It is huge, about 1 mile across. There are always seven of these large ships in the petroglyphs. These are the seven golden cities.
Of course, that sounds like an incredible theory, but just imagine, if you had never seen an aeroplane or even a bicycle, how would you explain a spaceship? Where did they go? Why did they go? Will they return? Perhaps these are the real questions about the seven golden cities. It seems that every day we make new discoveries. Those hidden in the past and those waiting for us in the future. I'm Patrick Macnee. Join me next time for more mysteries, magic, and miracles.